It's interesting to name Underwood. I said my primary thing was breeding seahorses, and what I'm hoping to do tonight is to essentially my objective is to show you that anyone can keep seahorses. They're really not that difficult if you know what you're doing and send them across. And I hope they'll just play some of the rumors that you hear about seahorses. The picture you see up there is a video of a seahorse fire that was a few days old. Started breeding seahorses back in 2003 when we first moved back to Florida, and we spent 2 years experimenting, trying to learn everything we could about seahorses. And beginning of 2005, January 2005, we started our company, Seahorse Source. And over the period of years, we've had several different species. I think close to a dozen. I think I have them all listed. The recognition we got was Osprey and Pluto being the primary ones that we've bred most of the time. Our website is seahorsesource.com. We also have a Facebook page. And attached to our Facebook page, we have a group. And the group covers all the different how-tos, people that have questions, and it's designed to be more of an educational thing. People do post pictures and stuff, but our primary purpose is for it to be educational. People always wonder what it looks like inside of our place. Breeding seahorses seems like a really cool thing, but the reality is 90% of it is janitorial. Our setups on the picture to the round blue tanks. Those are 90 gallon tubs which we use for the frog. And the picture over to the right, once they get big enough, we'll move them to the glass tanks. And in the fry tanks, this is typically what they should look like when we're being successful. We'll have anywhere from 200 to 600 seahorses inside of a round tank like that. Until they get too big, we can move them to another tank. And the picture here, I sent a quick picture of putting together a system. This is a typical sump setup that we have for our systems. And we use this for the fry systems, we use it for the grow out, and we use it for the brood stock. And it's a pretty simple system where we use a variable speed DC pump, and that goes up to a 5 micron cartridge filter, and then it tees off one side going up towards the tanks, the other side coming down to a homemade bioreactor. Where we use K1 polymer media because it can handle such a high load. Some of our tanks will take up to a quarter pound of feed per day. And then we have a protein skimmer. And coming from the tanks, we come down to a 100 micron sock. And we used to keep the blue bio balls in a container, which we're starting to do away with. And if anybody's paying attention, this was putting the system together, the little skimmer here. We did do that away from the glass. This is our little Artemia tank, which we get a shipment in each week. We get about 3 times what the average store gets in, and we use that to enrich the broodstock and the grow out seahorses. The picture on the other side is our Artemia hatching station, where we hatch our Artemia, enrich it, and basically prepare all the food for the frog. But getting on to the seahorses, keeping seahorses is actually quite easy, despite what many people will tell you, provided we have a proper setup and we give them the proper care. These little guys have been around for millions of years. Not other creatures have evolved. When you look at those fish, they've evolved from way back to where seahorses were millions of years ago. Seahorses have remained pretty much like they've been since the very beginning. Throughout history, they've always been considered mysterious creatures because of their shape and what they look like, and they're just different. And not only visually, but internally as well. When you start to do some research on seahorses, the first thing you're going to find is a lot of conflicting information. The unfortunate thing about the web is that it provides a lot of quick information, but unfortunately, bad information doesn't go away. And the credentials of who you're reading from are not always, anybody can post anything at any time. Unlike a textbook, you find the textbook, you got the updated version, all the bad information or old information disappears on the web, it just stays there. So it's a good idea when you're setting up a system to find somebody who is successful with keeping seahorses and go with them in terms of getting set up. And some of the information you'll hear about seahorses is things like they don't need a big tank, a small tank is fine. And quite often you go into a fish store and somebody wants to buy a seahorse, that's the first thing that I tell them, you don't need a big tank. The reality is, too small of a tank, they're just not going to do well. And I'll tell you, they don't move around much because that's why you don't need a big tank. But argue that if you take a world-class athlete walking up in a closet for 6 months, I bet he's not going to like it either. You do need some space to move around. A lot of people think they're poor swimmers. The reality is, despite their vertical orientation, the fact that they don't have a collar or tail fin, they use their dorsal fin for propulsion. They're actually quite good swimmers and actually much faster than you think they can swim. However, they don't have a lot of endurance. They don't swim for long periods of time. Another rumor that you're convincing or hear is the slow, low flow. And the reality is, just like any other tank, you want as much flow as you can get to keep everything in suspension so the filters can remove. Seahorses will handle much more flow than people give them credit for. It just needs to be low enough. You just don't want jet streams going across. It used to be that everybody said they made it for life. And the reality is that if you take a male and a female seahorse, put them in the same tank, you may as well be putting a pair of teenagers in the back of a 57 Chevy with a driver and supervised. Big little changes. The number of species, CITES, which is the governing authority on the international trade, recognizes 30 some odd species. Right now, there are up to somewhere close to 50 to 60 species that are now recognized. And the number is growing, they're finding new species all the time. I don't know what the exact number is, and depending upon who you talk to, you'll hear different stories. As far as we're concerned in the hobby, there's only about a handful that we really deal with. Some of the species that are out there just aren't suitable for the hobby. Another thing you often hear is they eat copepods, and copepods, you know, are great for some things, but for a seahorse, they can eat somewhere, depending upon the age, the size, the study of the species, they eat anywhere between 5 to 20% of their weight per day, which is quite a bit. When you look at the size of the seahorse, that's quite a bit. And copepods are simply too small, they don't have enough mass, and you do not rely on feeding on copepods in the tank to sustain them. It's just simply not enough. Kind of like you and I, you ride as one grain at a time. You also hear that they're endangered, on the verge of extinction, and there's a lot of things that are said about this with seahorses. It's true that some of the species are currently endangered, and there's been some overfishing in certain parts of the world, but I can tell you that in the United States, the species we have here, there are plenty. And in many places, there's still plenty. And since seahorses are different than regular fish, some of the things are quite obvious. They've got these horse-looking-like head. They have a prehensile tail. They've got a collar and their pelvic fin. They have a vertical posture in the water column, and they're upright. Horizontal like most fish. Males get pregnant, which is kind of cool. They can change color, they can change patterns, and they can grow or they can lose what's called cerite. That's the stuff that looks like hair coming off of the fawns. They use that for camouflage. And then they have an exoskeleton with segmented body parts. They have a different type of gill structure than regular fish. Closed operculum, their gills are kind of tufted, almost like round balloons like inside. They have a fixed jaw, they don't open up their mouth and swallow things, they have to slurp things in instead. and in the process of massacring the food. You watch the seahorse eat. It's kind of cool. It almost looks like a dragon puffing smoke out of the back of their head. Because they stick in the food, they massacre it. Most of it they consume, but somewhere close to around 8% of it will come right out of the gills back into the water column and contribute to the organic growth in the tank. They don't have a true stomach. Their digestive system is very rudimentary. They have a, instead of a true stomach, they have a kind of like an enlarged area of the intestine where the food first goes in. And because of the lack of a true stomach, they also don't have the gut associated lymphoid tissue that's found in those fish. Now, the gut associated lymphoid tissue is what's typically responsible for the adaptive immunity. And seahorses do have adaptive immunity, but it's poorly understood. I call it a weird immune system. And because of the lack of the stomach, the digestive process is relatively quick. The transit time from being eaten takes about 10 hours from what goes in before it comes back out. And about 23 to 25% of that's going to be undigested. So they take in a lot of food, and part of the reason they take in so much food is their inability to really consume it all and use it all. When you look at the anatomy of the seahorse, this picture really helps. A lot of people wonder which one's a male, which one's a female. The male has a pouch underneath the abdomen where the female does not. And the reason the male is called a male is because when the female transfers the eggs to the male fertilizes the eggs, so technically he is a male. He has a sperm. The internal workings of a seahorse, if you're interested, pretty simple. Things are a little bit in different order than in some fish, but most of us, people aren't going to look at that too much. Okay, setting up a tank. As you guys know, there's probably 10 gazillion different ways to set up a tank. And in the seahorses, your best bet is to start up with a tank that's designed for them. And you can retrofit a tank, take a tank and convert it over to a seahorse tank, but people that have been around in the hobby for many years will start with a new system altogether. You want a minimum 29 to 30 gallons for each pair of, for the first pair of seahorses, and then another 25 to 30 gallons for each additional pair. And you can sometimes get away with a little bit smaller than that, assuming that you have the right setup with the sump and larger water volume elsewhere. The tank should be roughly 18 inches tall or still more. And a lot of people will tell you you need a really, really tall tank for seahorses, and that's not true. They need horizontal space as much as they need vertical space. And for that reason, I don't recommend the tall, skinny tanks like a 30 extra tall or some of the small hexagon tanks. I also don't recommend a tank that's any taller than what you can reach. From a maintenance standpoint, I've seen people buy a 110 extra tall, and the only way to get to the bottom is put the back of the waist on, and your children bend over the waist to get to the bottom, especially for some of the shorter people. So I recommend staying somewhere probably more so than the 25 to 26 inch range. I do prefer systems with a sump. The sump gives you a higher degree of flexibility and gives you more options in terms of equipment. And of course, the hang on the back type of equipment gets real cluttered. And it also, depending upon the tank that you use, it can limit what you can put in. Bio cubes are great looking tanks. From an aesthetic standpoint, I love them. However, they lack flexibility, and most of the people that I've seen with bio cubes, they have a tendency to run them. And seahorse tanks, you have a tendency to keep them cooler than most of your tropical tanks. Okay, once we have a tank for a substrate, I recommend sand bottom or bare bottom. Stay away from crush bowl or gravel. Try to select quickly crush coal and gravel, and if you go with that type of substrate, somewhere between 9 months to a year down the road, we'll probably be calling people up, researching out how to deal with algae placema, with the seahorse that they are trapped in the pouch, gas bubble disease, and some of the other problems. Keeping the crush full of gravel clean enough is very difficult for seahorses because they eat a lot, which means they also excrete a lot. And they just simply, the organics will build up, and as the organics build up, that increases like the bile activity, and you start having somewhere down the road, you start having issues. The sand or the bare bottom keeps the detritus up to the top, makes it easier to remove it when it's needed, and for the cleanup crew to do it. Water flow, ignition, we want as much as we can put in the tank and still have the seahorse is comfortable. It should be broken up, but you don't want to get streams blasting across the tank where there were somersaults. I've got one friend who squares up and down, gets turnover rate at 40 turns per hour. And he did it by setting up spray bars and having some of the stuff on behind the rocks and on top. If you're creative, you can break it up and you can have a really high turnover. But you want a minimum of 10 turns per hour for the seahorse tank. Biological filtration is like any other tank, you want it adequate to handle the anticipated load. Seahorses do put a big load on a system. 55 with, say, three pairs of seahorses is like having a 55 with a stock of fish. They put a huge bio load on a tank. For filtration, we want some type of filter that very good at removing particulate matter, whether that be a series of different pads or a canister filter of some sort, but something that can remove small particulate matter. And in some, I like using a 100 micron filter bag, and then I use a cartridge filter going back to the tank. We also run an oversized protein skimmer with seahorses, usually at least twice what the tank is rated for. The little skimmers that I'm using on my systems are the SCA 302s, and those are rated for 180 gallons.
It gets 5 miles now.
Wall Studio?
It'll cool off when it'll go back on.
UV sterilizer is not something that's mandatory on a seahorse tank. It's not a bad thing to have. The problem I have with UV sterilizers for many people is they give a false sense of security. The UV sterilizers will only affect what passes through them, not what's in the tank. Most of the things that we're concerned about with seahorses, such as bacteria or heterotrophic bacteria, which typically form biofilms. And most of that is not going to go through the UV. If you have multiple tanks and you're attaching the seahorse tanks to a system of other tanks, the UV sterilizer would be good in terms of isolating the tank. The other thing that the UV can do is help reduce your total loading in the system through direct hydroxyl production, advanced oxidation, as well as disassociation of the particles in the organics. That in turn makes it easier for the equipment to remove some of that organic matter. For setting up the system, temperature will depend upon what type of seahorse you have. There's basically two classes. When it comes to temperature, tropical and temperate, or what we call cold water species. The tropical species will do best at 72 to 74 degrees. You'll find less problems at that temperature range. You can keep them anywhere from 69 to 77 for most of them. And some of the species, like Erectus, can go down much, much lower than that if need be. The challenge for us down here is keeping our tanks at a cooler temperature if the house isn't got cool with the AC. Temperate or cold water species, typically 55 to 68 degrees is where we want to keep them, and that usually requires a chiller. It can be done without a chiller, which I approved from the chiller room 2 weeks ago, and I'm still waiting on a replacement. But I've got my tank back down to 67 degrees in that room with the use of turning down the AC and 5 foot-long fans blowing on the tank. And a fan blowing the AC directly to the tank. As far as what you can put in with the Seahorses and what we call tank banks, there's two websites that are real good in terms of telling you what's good to go with the Seahorses. One is seahorse.org, the other is fusejaw.com. And see, I like the one on seahorse.org better because they've got pictures and it, both of them pretty much are very close in terms of how they rate things. And they essentially use a rating system of 0 to 4, with 0 being perfectly safe and 4 being able to eat your seahorse. The smaller the tank, the more limited you are in terms of what you should put in there, which kind of makes sense. The larger the tank, the more, the higher in the range you can go, the things that are a little bit more aggressive. You know, I've seen seahorse tanks that were 1,500 gallons and they had things that were in the dream of putting in a 30 gallon tank. But there was room enough that things were good. As far as lighting goes, it's not critical for seahorses. Usually most people set up their lights when what else is in there. Typically the macros or the corals or whatever else they keep it in there. The seahorses will do fine in lower lighting or even higher lighting situations. I do like LEDs, and I do, I find that at least in our shop, if we keep them around 6,065K, that's when we get the best coloration of the seahorses. The LEDs seem to help pull the colors out of them better than the typical fluorescents or halides. As far as your parameters go, I keep it very simple. No one in the nitrates, pH can be somewhere above 8, and salinity can be variable 28 to 36 pounds per thousand. Most of the horses come out of estuaries where different times the salinity goes up, the pH swings a lot, temperature swings a lot, and the local is good enough where I have full fears. I've reported up to 8 degree swings during tidal changes. 6 hour time frame between low tide and high tide. And the salinity, when it's raining, you've got fresh water pouring in, and the pH will alter because of all the nutrients coming in, and the seahorses seem to thrive in that environment. As far as what we put in the tank in terms of species, most people when they set up a tank, they set up a community tank with different types of fish, either peacefully or cohabitate together. In the seahorse world, we recommend keeping one species of seahorses per tank. And the reason we do that is that it's kind of weird. Sometimes when you mix two or more species in the same tank, you end up with some strange bacterial issues. And this goes back to their immune system. The common theory amongst most people is that some seahorses have a gut flora that they've gotten used to and are able to handle, but the other seahorses are not used to and become pathogenic towards them. There's no science or studies to prove this, but we know from past experience that at least some people in mixed species are going to have issues. We don't know what the true statistics are because what we see is what people report. The people that have problems don't report, people that have issues are the ones obviously screaming their health. In terms of feeding your seahorses, once you have the tank set up within the tank, you want to feed them a minimum of twice a day, 3 times being ideal, we have more. We feed the shop, we feed up to 6-7 times a day, essentially every 2 hours. In a home setting, most people have to work for a living, so most people will feed them in the morning when they get home from work, and then sometime later on in the evening. As far as foods, frozen mices, captive bred seahorses is the primary food we feed, which makes it much more convenient. It wasn't, you know, just 10, 15 years ago that about half the seahorses on the market were only by food. Today, almost all the seahorses are being sold, at least the captive bred ones, are being already trained in frozen mices. The other foods these guys eat, amphipods, is big. Amphipods is probably the primary food in the wild, followed by ices. We can also do ghost shrimp and enriched filter brine shrimp, as I mentioned before. Copepods are too small. Okay, quick review as far as the tank goes. We want a minimum of 29 gallons with 25 to 30 gallons to prepare each pair after that. We want to use sand or bare bottom. We want to have water fill up as high as we can tolerate, a minimum of 10 tons per hour. Adequate biological filtration, really good mechanical filtration, including a skimmer. We want to keep our temperatures within the proper ranges. At least in the beginning, start with tank mates that are easy to deal with. Lighting is not critical, species one per tank, and feedings minimum twice a day, hopefully a few times. In terms of where to buy your seahorses, you essentially have put three on. You really have four choices. You have the local fish store, online vendors, and of course, direct from a reef. And of course, there's sometimes you can find other hobbyists that's getting rid of them, or some experts, or what have you. That can be another source. Local fish stores, there's some really good ones out there with seahorses, and there's some really bad ones with seahorses. The problem is with seahorses is that it takes specialized knowledge, a lot of store owners or employees just aren't trained and knowledgeable on seahorses, and they have a tendency to pass on information of what they know, which is not always correct. Your online vendors, typically that's, you go online, the place where they arrive, there's pretty simple, pretty cut and dry. A lot of times they're shipped directly from the wholesaler to you. And then direct from the breeder, the advantage there is that you're bypassing all the handling the seahorse goes through the chain. Whether they're not being shipped to a wholesaler, they're not going to the live store, you're getting them direct to you. The other big thing is when you buy from the breeder, should you have questions or issues, they're probably going to be your best place for support. We run contracts and we typically have, I'd say, over 50% of our help calls are from people who do not buy seahorses from us, but from somewhere else, could find them to help if they need. Your consideration when you're buying the seahorses, questions that you should consider and ask them where you're buying from. Bred in the United States or be imported. And the difference there typically shows up in the price of the seahorses. A lot of the imports come from the Asian market, the Philippines, Indonesia, Sri Lanka. Most of those are going to be much cheaper. They're also going to be much smaller, and the quality is not going to typically be as high. There's still some methods being used and other methods of breeding. That's not to say there aren't good breeders over there, there are. But they're typically much smaller, too small, at least in my eyes, to be sold. The next thing you want to know is whether or not you want to support after the sale. If you think you're ready to strike off on your own and can handle everything, not a big deal. But if you'd like to get the support, you want to try to buy your seahorses from somebody who's going to help along the way. If you're buying in a store or online, ask what species it is. If it's listed as a yellow seahorse or black seahorse, you have no clue. All the seahorses can be yellow, all the seahorses can be black, so it's best to buy seahorses that are listed by their actual name. And even then, sometimes, unfortunately, it's not always the store's fault, sometimes it comes from the distributor, but sometimes they're recycled still. They should be eating frozen food. If they're not, then there's something wrong either with the seahorse or they're not captive bred seahorses. And in size, they should be at least 3 inches in size. If they're any smaller than that, we consider them too young to sell. The ideal size for a seahorse is going to be somewhere 3.5 to 4.5 inches in terms of buying a seahorse. And it puts them about the equivalency of a teenager. They're the most adaptable. They handle the shipping and everything the best. Buying really large seahorses, they're full grown, can sometimes be problematic because they're already set in ways. They don't handle their transfers as nicely as the other ones do. And whenever you buy a seahorse, do not, it's so hard because we set up moving tanks because they're colorful, they're beautiful, and they're really striking. So it's natural for people to want, you know, a nice, bright, beautiful seahorse, but paying for color markings and made of pears simply doesn't make sense. The picture you see on the right-hand side with the big blue seahorses there came from an online vendor. And basically, they were imported in the United States. Vendor received them, shipped them to me, they were all black. This picture was taken 2 weeks after I got them. And my job was to turn them yellow and send them back to him so he could sell them as yellow seahorses. Okay, some of the commonly available species. I'm going to run through these. These are what you're going to most commonly find. Atractus is probably the most common seahorse you're going to find in the United States. They're native to the United States. They're found all the way from Maine, or actually Nova Scotia, all the way down to South America and the Gulf of Mexico. They're one of the easier species to breed, and they're very hardy. As a consequence, you'll find that they're usually the number one seahorse recommended for somebody starting off. But you'll also find that people that have been keeping seahorses for years, quote unquote experts, also keep them as well. The H. breedi is one of the more sought after species because they have a tendency to be very colorful, often more brightly colored than some of the other species. They're also known as the Brazilian seahorse. If they're true captive bred from the United States, they're usually quite hardy. If they're coming in the imports, it depends upon where they're coming from. Sometimes a couple of breeders that ship them over, just the quality isn't there and they're simply not very hardy at all. Again, a lot of this you can tell by the size, because the U.S. breeders will typically won't sell them until they're up in the 3.5 to 4 inch range. If you see them listed as 2 inches, then really recommend you stay away from. H. cuda is actually more like should be called the H. cuda complex, as there are several subspecies within what's listed as H. cuda. You have the Tenoropterus from Australia, you have the Lomas from Hawaii, and what's known as the cuda from the Indo-Pacific area. And all of those, if they're true captive bred in the U.S. and we find them quite hardy, they have a tendency to turn to the yellow or orange tones, thus the name yellow seahorse. They're a smoother looking body to them, and they can change their colors around a little bit, but they're most commonly going to be in the yellow to lone yellow to the color. The HBI and the cuda are more difficult to breed than Atractus. They're much more difficult, and as a consequence, you won't see a lot of home breeders breeding them successfully, more with the Atractus. H. barbary is kind of a cool seahorse. They're much more delicate. They're slower to grow, eat, move about. It seems like everything they do is slower. The time it takes us to raise the rectus to market, it takes 3 times as long to raise the barbary. I usually don't recommend them as the first seahorse, and you'll find that they're typically command a much higher price in the market because they have smaller batches of flight and they're so slow, and they're seasonal in terms of breeding. So in the time that it takes me to breed, say 100 barbary, I can breed over 1,000 rectus. H. indigens is native to the Pacific Coast in the United States and down into South America. Currently, there's no one in the United States actively breeding them. There's a couple of people that are starting up again. Almost all the indigens you see on the market are coming out of Mexico, and typically, you'll find them being sold at 2 to 3 inches, and I really recommend that unless they're 4 inches or more, stay away from the species. This species is very big. They get up to 12 inches in length. They look very much like H. breedi, but they're more near as hardy as the other species. And as a consequence, they're getting small and being very difficult to keep them going. You won't find many people that have had each injury for a long period of time because they're not as hardy. The aging homes of the tiger tail seahorse is kind of a cool seahorse. They're considered nocturnal. If you've already had seahorses, people first seen them, they kind of freak out a little bit because they act different. They're more active in the early morning and late evening. They feed a little bit. They're a little bit slower in feeding than the rectus, the kudu, or the reed-eye. Most of what you see on the market are imports. ORA has been breeding them of late and doing a very nice job with them. We're in the process of bringing our breed stock up, and we'll start breeding them again. If at all possible, again, I recommend buying them for the U.S. year. The aged adult males are the popular seahorses, cold water species. These guys are really cool. They, thus the name of the popular is because of the big belly they have. They're very active seahorses. They're very large. They're fun to watch. They require a chiller, they require a much larger tank. Ancient Zostrae or the dwarf seahorses are native to this area, up and down the both coast of Florida, down into part of the Caribbean, over to the Bahamas. These guys are tiny, tiny little guys. To give you an idea, you take a dwarf seahorse and then across your thumbnail, and that's about how they're. There's a lot of people that want to buy them and see pictures of them. And looking at the picture, they look big, but when you see them in real life, they're these little bitty things. And if I was just setting them up at home, I would probably have a telescope next to my easy chair. They're really that small. We did a morning convention in Chicago one year. We set up a 15-gallon tank and put 200 of them in it, 15 tall, and it didn't look over there. These guys require a lot of foods, so if you set up a dwarf tank, typically most people will use a 2.5 to 5 gallon tank, and you're going to have to hatch our team there for as long as you need them if you want to keep them alive. And not only do you need to hatch the RT in, but you also need to enrich it to correct the nutritional value if you want these guys to do well. I swiped a few pictures of some seahorse tanks. How different people set them up. In general, I like to have macros in a seahorse tank. I like to think of a seahorse tank more like a refugio than I do. Most people, you know, try to set up seahorses in a reef tank. Seahorses really aren't a reef creature. They're more of an estuary type creature. And they're usually found around grass areas and places where you can find the food that they don't need, such as shrimp and anything box, what have you. So, I have a tendency not to put as much rock in when I'm setting up a display tank as what most rich people will do. I don't try to put 50 tons inside of a 10-gallon tank or something like that. I like to have a few nice pieces, and then I rely more on my filtration and the sump over a hang on that filters. Another picture of the tank setup. And another. You can see the little seahorse up there. And as far as problems with seahorses, common elements that you'll see like any other fish, they're subject to bacterial infections. Very common with them is, in terms of bacterial infections, is tail rot, which can be caused by bacteria, Borgia, parasite, weak snick, gas bubble disease, pouch emphysema, which is where they get air trapped in their pouch, and of course, the sores. All of these are very easy to prevent if you have the proper setup and the proper care, kept at the proper temperature. I've had customers that had seahorses, the same seahorse, up to 11 years. You go to a fish store, they'll often tell you they don't live very long. The reality is that the setup, the way that I've been describing this evening, has been based upon 15 years of me watching people, dealing with people, I'm active on forums, Facebook, help desk, etc. And I looked at the people who have been the most successful in terms of keeping the seahorses, and they follow a common theme, and the common theme is the setup that I've been describing this evening. terms of what to have on hand for a seahorse, in terms of dealing with issues. A lot of people have a quarantine tank in case the seahorse is pinned down. Hospital tank is perfectly fine. You want to have some type of a wide spectrum antibiotic and some type of antiparasitic. The only recommended cure on two is the antibiotic, and formalin is the antiparasitic. Formalin works very well with seahorses, and they tolerate it very well. Some of the other things, without the asterisk, you can pick up as needed, such as a topical antiseptic, anesthetic. Catheter is used for two purposes, one for force feeding a seahorse if they're not eating and you have to manually feed them, and if they get ouchy, the seaweed, you can use a catheter to let the air out of the ouch. Disposable gloves, of course, ideally you want a phone number of somebody who knows what they're doing if you're having an issue that you don't know how to address. Questions?
A 3-inch fry that or young seahorse that you consider a good size to be selling is about how old?
It depends upon the breeder, because they're going to grow in relation to how much they'll be in bed. In our particular setup, we find they grow roughly an inch a month for the first 4 months.
So about 3 or 4 months old.
But I've also seen, you know, some home breeders that had seahorses that were 6 months old, but they're still 3 inches. So, you know, the advantage is that we're dumping the food in and fish are going to grow based upon the foliage. Yes?
Given the ideal conditions, what's life expectancy?
I'm sorry, can you hear me?
Given ideal conditions, what's life expectancy?
Life expectancy under ideal conditions.
I'm sorry, what is the life expectancy?
Yeah.
It depends on the species. If you take the smaller species, they don't live as long as the larger ones. So the zostrate, for example, there's a lot of people say they live for a year. My experience is somewhere closer to 2 years. I've had one live up to 3 years. The larger seahorses, which you'll typically find on the market, we don't know exactly. We don't know how long they live in the wild, but we do know in captivity it's very common for people 5 to 7 years. The longest that I've seen with your H. erectus was 11 years from one of my first customers. H. reedi I've kept. When they came into trade, they were adults. Well, the first I had them before, we had them for 5 years. And I did a trade, took them, and I had them for 5 years. And after that, I retired them to a restaurant huge tank, and I had no idea how old they were. They were more than 10 years, and the males were up to 12 inches, and the females were between 9 and 10 inches. So seahorses will continue to grow throughout their lifespan, and that's one of the key indicators I can tell, you know, looking at the seahorse, how old they are. Yes, sir.
And how old do they have to be to breed, and how old?
How old do they have to be what?
To breed them?
Yeah. And is it size or is it age or both?
It's when they're sexually mature. As soon as the male starts developing a pouch, they're capable. And as soon as the female develops her parts, she's capable. The H. erectus, I've seen breed as early as 3.5 months for the southern variety and 3 months for the northern variety. Most of the species will be somewhere between 3.5 to 4 months is when they can start. Not every one of them breed, but if we hang on to them, if we get overstocked, we have the issue that our babies are having babies.
They're like little bunnies. They're bunnies of the sea.
How difficult is for the fry to survive?
I'm sorry.
Like, if you breed them in a tank, you need to separate the fry and feed them separately. And
yes.
How difficult is that?
Well, separate
variety and the parents have
it. Yeah, you can move the parents in one way, you can do it. Our tanks are set up so the fry will move down into the sump. We don't have this typical overflow. We drill our own tanks and use a standby with a special screening line so the fry will come down. And that way we don't have to move the adults. And the way that I do it, I simply size them into a shipping bag, and then I can move them to the fry tank and acclimate them and put them in. You can move the adult to the fry tank. And then some people will use a cup or something like that and scoop each one out. But you know, some of the species can have quite large batches. The H. reedi, 4th of July, probably somewhere around 2008, 2009, we had a batch of fry, and we used to count them. And my wife stopped in 2000, and she informed me she was never going to do that again.
So you're a grandfather.
Sorry?
So you're a grandfather.
Is there a question?
Yeah, is there any triggering for temperature changes or that you do to encourage them to breed or feed?
Sometimes you can. So each species is a little bit different. Like the H. reedi, the H. kudu, once they get going, they're like every 2 weeks, almost like a ball. And you really don't have to do anything. The rectus are a little bit more seasonal to some degree. Some of them will breed regularly, some of them will not. And in those cases, if we find that their reduction has dropped off, then we will manipulate both the lighting and the temperature to try to influence them to breed. And most commonly, what works best for us is dropping the temperature and shortening the lighting. Some people will raise and lengthen, but we find that when we shorten the light and decrease the temperature, That seems to kick them in the
air. So more like fall and winter, kind of thing?
Yeah. Or you have to get it down before it's too late.
We caught seahorses right outside of the seaquarium.
Yep.
A lot of them.
You know, they're all over the place, and it cracks me up because when I look at some of these studies where they go out and they try to do counts of how many seahorses are out there, I've seen people, I've taken people out before, and gone in the flats and collect, go out and seine and dip nets and stuff to see the seahorses, even though we weren't taking them. But I've seen people look directly at them and don't see them. And you know, they go out and supposedly do a count, but in this amount of space they found X amount of seahorses, and then they're trying to say that they decreased or didn't, you know. And the problem is that even the little bitty dwarfs can move as much as a mile around in a given geographic area. The collectors will tell you that they move based upon the predominant winds, where the water is calmer, and
also food source.
And the food source. And there was an article that was put out in a paper in Tampa about a month ago. And a young lady went out doing a study and found 50 seahorses in one day. And that's unheard of. I mean, she's got a good eye. She knew where to look. They're out there. And if you talk to any of the bait guys, they catch seahorses all the time with their gas nets. You know, where they're going after the bait is where the seahorses are. Yes?
Are there any challenges with keeping like a single gender tank, having only females or only males? Do they tend to be better or worse or no difference?
That's a great question. In a captive environment, it doesn't matter. Or I should say, with captive bred specimens, it doesn't matter. Sometimes we all call specimens, they're a little fancy, but with the captive bred specimens, they're so used to being in such a high density that they don't care. You put two females together, two males together. The two males, sometimes if they're young, will do the recording thing that they practice with each other instead of with a female. They'll do perfectly fine in that setting. If you don't want to have fry, don't want to deal with that issue, that is the best way to do it.
Do adults eat their babies in the fry? Do the adults, are you going to eat the fry if you don't take them out?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no. Usually believe they did, but I can tell you that I've had a couple of instances where if I don't get to the fry immediately, the female will eat them. And if you've got multiple broodstock in the tank, I mean, in a matter of about 30 minutes,
Can you separate the male, the pregnant male, into a fry tank and let him have the fry there?
You can.
Would that stress him out?
It depends upon the setup, and you know, there's some variables involved, and there's a couple that we do that with because of the females that will go after the fry. When I do it in the same tank without stressing. Sometimes it throws off the breeding schedule.
Could you have it down with like a screen divider that you can put on and separate the male and the female and leave them in the same tank?
You could, but you know, I actually devised a round screen device that I could put the male in to keep all the fry contained, and it seems stressed inside of it. If he sees a female and can't get to her, that's going to create issues. It's a better thing to move them entirely. Unless you put a, you know, a solid divider that was color graded and see them.
Like acrylic or something.
Yeah, but colored so he can't see through it.
Yeah. I mean, black acrylic paints.
Are you using cell phones or enriching your...
No, I use a product called Nancy. We did some experiments. Cell photo is a good product, there's nothing wrong with it. Using cell photo, the problem is that the shelf life. Once it's open, if it's packaged properly, it's packaged with nitrogen, you keep it in one ransom. And once you open it, you get oxygen in there. If you don't use it within 30 days, it's going to start going bad. And the feed that we use a blend of different dried algaes that are very high in the DHA to EPA ratio. And we put the other additives in there that we want for the fry. So it's a powder, and it has a 2-year shelf life. And it's just, from the standpoint of usage, it's just better for us because of the nutritional value and because of the shelf life. It's a little bit more of a pain in the butt because it is an hour and a half to put it on leather before you use it.
Are there any hybrids? Any hybrid breeding? Crossbreeding?
There is. Interesting subject. We occasionally have hybrids from the Redot and Erectus. The Redot and Erectus are a pair of species that can mix without having much issue. They're both Atlantic seahorses. For some reason, we don't seem to have much of a problem mixing. And when we first started doing the hybrids, it was actually by accident. One of the scientists that I worked with at FIT put some erectus and Redot together, didn't realize they could crossbreed, and they did. So we started doing experiments when they started breeding, and she wrote a couple of different papers on those. And then that brought up the question that through DNA testing, some of the aquariums were complaining that they were buying seahorses from breeders that had Redot, and they thought there was crossbreeding happening at the breeder. But what we found is by taking some wild seahorses and running the DNA testing, they actually crossbreed in the wild. And what's interesting is that we found that so far, what we've seen is that if you take two hybrids and put them together, they won't breed. A hybrid typically won't breed with a hybrid, but they will breed back to either